This is Jason Artiga, and this is another episode of Cinema Macabro. In our sixth scary episode, the Alien Covenant review. Now, it took me about a week and a half to see this film, and my expectations weren't that high, and they weren't that low. They got kind of pretty much medium when I saw the Adam Savage footage of him going behind the sets of Ridley Scott directing and the creature effects and prop shop. I said, you know what? I might have hopes for this. I went in, saw the film, and I was right. Alien Covenant is not a bad film. It's a good film, but it has lots of flaws. A lot of gaps in the story, underdeveloped group of characters, and some might even dispute the CG alien. You know, I'm used to a guy in a suit and the effects of Carlo Rambaldi, H.R. Giger, and the work of Stan Winston on Aliens, and not to mention Studio ADI, who worked on Alien 3. Alien Covenant begins with a crew going out into a remote galaxy to this planet that they're supposed to go to, where they're going to colonize along with hundreds of colonists who are in cryosleep. Before they go, this accident happens and the captain dies. Aurum, played by Billy Crudup, ends up taking the reins as captain, and they get this distress signal, which sounds a lot like Country Road by John Denver, and they touch down on this remote planet that has vegetation, a breathable atmosphere, and they decide to set down on this planet. Upon setting down, some of the crew get sick from breathing spores, and they eventually meet David, who's played by Michael Fassbender, who also plays a dual role in this as another android named Walter. As they meet David, they slowly start to see the horrors of this paradise turned into a hellish-like nightmare. Now, I liked the film, but I had a lot of problems with this film. Like Prometheus, stupid writing. One thing is to cater to your audience like Dan O'Bannon, Ron Shutset, and Walter Hill did when they worked together on Alien. And the other thing is to assume that everybody watches the fucking Fast and Furious movies and think that they're dumbed down, like a dumbed down audience. You got the same template producers used on Prometheus. Hey, let's write cannon fodder. Let's make these scientists who've been training for years, or colonists in Alien Covenant view, do stupid things in stupid situations that require stupidity for them to get infected or easily killed. We need all that cannon fodder because our audience loves blood and gore. Well, that's where they're wrong. As a fan of both Alien and Aliens, two intellectual properties, Alien and Aliens has to be on my top 20 list of best films ever made. We're talking about really well-written films. You have Dan O'Bannon, one of the best screenwriters that ever lived, and you have James Cameron. To me, Aliens is the pinnacle of the franchise, and there's nothing that could hold a candle to those two films. I think Ridley Scott realized that and took liberties with the film and producers and writing. Not to take anything away from Ridley Scott. Ridley Scott is a master director. He has way too many films under his belt that are quality. Even ones that were shunned by critics, like Kingdom of God, which is an amazing film. Go see it. And the writing, I mentioned the stupid suit situations of Prometheus, but not to mention a good cast of talented actors. The second problem I had with the film was the overabundance of its cast. you had so many characters in a film, and yet you could not see any personalities develop, or you weren't emotionally connected enough to any of the crew members of the Covenant. You had Damien Bichir and one of the playing one of the colonists in the film with virtually nothing to do. He's a great actor. He's an Academy Award nominee. And you can't use that actor properly just to have him scream and have acid in his face. That's a spoiler. Danny McBride was surprisingly good in this film. I definitely see him in the future playing more dramatic roles. He was pretty good as Tennessee. Catherine Waterson was good in the film. However, because of the rapid pace between acts and maybe some scenes that were cut, I felt like her character was not developed enough. It didn't have too much to work with because of going from one act to the other. And I felt like they were trying to channel Ellen Ripley in her role. So I think she was good, but I think the choices producers made along with the screenwriter didn't give her enough character development. Billy Crudup was actually good as the ship's captain, but I think that his dialogue was pure shit, especially like some monologue about faith. He should have been in the film a little longer. I actually liked his presence. Another thing that I have to point out that was a major negative was the use of the xenomorph in this film. Now, the aliens in this franchise are the antagonist. And there are so much ways you can progress these creatures in the films. Like, you go from alien, a drone, to the alien queen in Aliens. You see a major progression, and then you also show that they have intelligence. But I feel that all they were doing was just acting primal and just killing people and not giving, you know, they were basically used to go from one act to the other without suspense on high gear, which doesn't work. Because once you do that, you basically take away the mystery. You also take away the intrigue. And you take away the horror, because without suspense, you just have big budget jump scares. Film, there was no suspense like you would see in Alien or Aliens. And it was like such, for, you know, it was just strange that a 2-hour film has no suspense. Probably one good suspenseful scene where the alien gets on a ship. An actress, Waterson, tries to warn the crew. All right, that's good. But once the aliens are shown in this film, all they do is kill, kill, kill. There's no beat where you actually feel the terror like you did in Alien, where Kane gets a chest burster, and then he eventually, you know, the chest burster comes out, and they're looking for a small creature, and then a big creature appears and kills Brett. You see, there was enough time for you to feel the suspense of that film. That's why Alien is one of the best films. It's like a haunted house thriller in space. Another thing is the xenomorph life cycle being way, way too fast. There were scenes where somebody would get a face hugger and eventually a chest burster would pop up an hour later. And the same thing with the neomorph scene. They had innovative ways of the creatures coming out through people's backs and even a mouth, which was an idea taken from William Gibson's unproduced script of Alien 3. And if you haven't read that, you should. And I had trouble with them reinventing the rules of Alien Covenant. There were a lot of good things in this film. Michael Fassbender was one of the best things of this film. Playing to a dual role in this film was amazing. There's a scene where him and the other character he plays, Walter, he tries to teach him to play the flute. in his lair, and he gets saddened and disappointed that Walter can't create. He's an android with no feelings. And that's the thing. Walter is a very, David. David is a very complex character in Alien franchise series because he has emotions. And if you see the prologue film, you can see that he falls in love with Elizabeth Shaw, Dr. Elizabeth Shaw, which you would see later on. All in all, these problems, they didn't affect me in thinking this was a bad film. More like a poorly written film. Now, here are the good things. The effects were good. The CG on a Neomorph with practical effects, amazing. It's almost seamless. The Xenomorph was a mixed bag. Some of the CG shots were actually necessary now because you need to show the agileness of the Xenomorph. The facehugger was amazing. A lot of the effects were 3D printed, and I saw in an Adam Savage special of him being on a set of Alien Covenant of a suit that Danny McBride wore that was actually made from a 3D printer. So the grandiose vision of Ridley Scott was there because, as you know, Ridley Scott loves to shoot in huge sets. He doesn't like to solely rely on CG. The locations in this film are absolutely amazing and a breath of fresh air. And it's different than anything you would see in the Alien franchise, because in the Alien franchise, you're used to the claustrophobia of the Nostromo and Haley's Hope, LV-426, and the ship on Prometheus, the derelict ship and Prometheus itself, the prison of Alien 3. This was like this expansive, beautiful land. I don't know if it was Iceland they shot this in, but it was just amazing. Very good, amazing cinematography, and it was a good film. I would say go see this film. If you're a fan of the Alien series, you would definitely like this. This is, to me, better than Alien 3 and definitely better than Aliens versus Predator and AVPR. Now, here's the spoilers. I'm going to have a discussion now of the film and what I thought that has spoilers. One of those is the death of Elizabeth Shaw. If you saw the film, she basically looks like H.R. Giger's wonderful art piece called Lee. It's a biomechanical woman. And the effects artist probably took that as a reference for Elizabeth Shaw's demise. Her midsection opened up like really wide. You wonder what happened here. Did he harvest her eggs? Did he take whatever eggs she had in her body? Because I think she couldn't give birth. I think that was one of the problems of the character of Prometheus, and which made the whole her giving birth to the starfish creature towards the end. Thank you guys for watching this video. And if you got any comments, please leave them in the comment section. Please like this video and please subscribe to me. I could use more subscribers. And until the next video, take care.